let's keep going. And your sensory information will go to the spinal cord if it's from the body, and from the spinal cord will go contralateral because your brain is contralateral control. So like this, from the left, you'll go to the right side, eventually go to the right somatosensory cortex. And some go to a contralateral quicker than the other, like the pain, the temperature, the coarse touch will go contralateral to in the spinal cord part. And the fine touch, the vibration will in the brainstem part, it will go to the contralateral, but eventually it'll go to the contralateral. So it will stop in the brainstem first, or the spinal cord first, and the second neuron from the spinal cord to the thalamus. So the thalamus is like a train station. All the information move in, move out through your cortex will go through thalamus. And the third one from the thalamus to the somatosensory cortex. And we talk about the somatosensory cortex in the central nervous system. So here is like a review. It's in the postcentral gyrus. This line is called the central sulcus, and it's postcentral gyrus. So this is somatosensory cortex. And they call it primary because you have the secondary, the tertiary somatosensory cortex. But the ones, we only have time to talk about the primary somatosensory cortex. And we also talk about the map, right? You have a whole body map, so you have different neurons, and they generate action potential when different body parts being touched. They receive signals from the different body part. And we also talk about you have more neurons analyze information from the face, from the hand. So these are the sensitive body part. And corresponds to what we learned today, excuse me, your face, your finger, and they're gonna have small receptive field. And your body, these neurons, they have a big receptive field. So each neuron have to cover a big body part and their resolution is lower. So they are not so sensitive. Your finger, your face, especially your lips, and each neuron, their receptive field is pretty small. So their resolution is higher there. And also, if you draw your body based on the number of neurons, it's going to look like this. Right? It's called homunculus. So it tells you you have the very sensitive part in the hand, in the face, especially the lips. Okay, we cover all this in the central nervous system. Now let's look at something we did not cover last time. The pain sensation. The pain from your skin. So your skin have the free nerve ending. So that's the first sensory neuron we talk about. That's a simple one. That's a simple receptor. They don't have special structure. They just have free nerve ending on your skin. So if you damage your skin and those damaged tissue gonna release chemical signal, they will be picked up by the free nerve ending. They're gonna send the signal to your brain. You feel the pain sensation. And the temperature, your skin also have the temperature sensor. It sense the cold, sense the hot, and they have different sensor. But if the temperature go over 42 degrees, it's not the hot sensor, it's the pain sensor. So we're gonna talk about a girl who could not feel pain. It's called the congenital insensitivity of pain. It's a big word to say they were born, they could not feel pain. And she has no problem putting her hand into boiling water because she does not have the pain sensation. She can feel the hot, she could not feel the pain. Yeah, because over 42 degrees, the pain. And the pain transduction, let's look at the pain transduction. The neurotransmitter, so we have 12 different kinds of neurotransmitter. And the neurotransmitter used in the pain sensation is substance P. So that's the neurotransmitter, substance P. So all the neurons for the pain sensation, they use substance P. And the signal from the peripheral, of course. So you damage your tissue, accidentally cut yourself, okay, this chemical signal will be picked up by the free nerve ending and through the efferent neurons, so sensory neuron. You're going to go to the dorsal part of the spinal cord because that's where the sensory input move in. But the neurotransmitter is substance P. So different, your dorsal part, all the sensory goes through your dorsal part, but your spinal cord are able to tell, okay, that's the pain one, that's the other touch sensation, because they use a different neurotransmitter. So substance P is the neurotransmitter used for the pain. And from the spinal cord, goes through your brainstem, go to the thalamus, of course, from the thalamus, go to the somatosensory cortex. So still, your body sensation go to the somatosensory cortex. But But let's look at this. A big output will go to the reticular formation, this part of your brainstem part. Then this will go to your limbic system. Now I ask you, why? Why go to the limbic system? What's the function of the limbic system? Emotion, yeah. Memory, right? So amygdala, emotion, especially negative emotion. Memory, hippocampus, that's the limbic system. Why the pain sensation need to go to the limbic system? You've been burned. You remember it forever. That's the purpose. Your central nervous system, as I keep emphasizing, your central nervous system, the purpose is want you to survive. So you need to avoid damage your body. And you look at those toddler, or they touch everything, and they touch the light bulb only once. They know never touch it again. It hurts. The reason, this. So you go to a place, you've been hurt, or you met a guy, okay, you know, okay, this guy hurt me, and you remember it forever. Avoid this kind of person, avoid this place. And that's the purpose of this. So a big output of the pain, you say, why do we need to have a pain? You never have a good memory of pain sensation. Why we not just take it out? There's always a purpose. So the pain sensation, the purpose is to teach you avoid the damage. Avoid the damage. So you can live longer. And we actually have people, they have a gene mutation, they could not feel pain. It turned out their average life is shorter. And the big reason is they never feel like they have to protect themselves because they never feel the pain. And that's the purpose of the pain sensation. So even though you don't have a good experience of your pain sensation compared with the other senses, remember everything in your body, they have a reason to be there. So the purpose of the pain sensation is teach you, okay, remember it, never got hurt again. So you can take good care of your body. And let's look at this girl. She's born painless. So it's called the congenital insensitivity of pain. It's a big word. There's a big word to say you were born and you could not feel pain. And it's actually has a lot of challenges. So if you're interested, you can look at this article. So she's adult now. And this article talk about her mom's teaching her. Her mom spent a lot of time to help her to use the other senses to detect any possible pain. So she could not feel pain. And one story said in this article is her mom was teaching her to make spaghetti, and she accidentally dropped a spoon into the boiling water. And because she could not feel pain, so she has no problem. We talk about the temperature sensor, and over 42 degrees. It's not a hot sensor, it's the pain sensor. And because she could not feel pain, so she just put her hand into the boiling water and grabbed the spoon out. And after 3 minutes, she asked her mom, why my skin turned white? When her mom freaked out, take her to the emergency room. So it's very inconvenient if you could not feel pain. And there's a picture of her, cute, right? And you found, well, yeah, gloves. Why? Because when you were two, you bit your finger. And because she could not feel pain, she just keep eating her finger till it's bleeding. So her mom have to put gloves on her her hand to protect her finger. And her mom helped her to protect her finger, actually could not help her to protect her tongue. She chewed half of her tongue off when she was teasing. That's how they have figured out she could not feel pain. So it's very inconvenient when you could not feel pain, because if you can feel pain, you know to protect yourself. That's a story of another person. She also have the congenital insensitivity of pain. It turned out she died at a young age. And because she could not feel pain, so the small damage turned into the bigger one. Eventually she died. So if she can feel pain, she can probably avoid it. And let's look at the phantom pain. Phantom pain is not new. It's pretty old. If you look at the literature, 18th century, 19th century, they all report phantom pain. And they come from the people, they lose an arm, they lose a leg, and they report the pain from their arm, their limb, they don't have anymore. And they call it the phantom pain because, well, those people, they were not treated well. And they think, okay, you don't have an arm and you feel the pain from the arm. Where it come from? It must be the goat. So they call it the phantom pain. And they beat those persons. Sometimes they kill them. Till World War II is the time we have a lot of veterans. They lose an arm, they lose a leg. And they report a big pain from the arm they don't have anymore. And that's when we have a big data to study what's the reason of phantom pain. So after World War II, that's the mid-20th century, they start to have explanation of phantom pain. It's not the ghost. It comes from not the limb, right? Because there's no stimulus. It comes from the neuronal activity. So to explain the phantom pain, we have to explain it from the neuron level. So that's the somatosensory cortex. You are very familiar with it. And they have different neurons analyze the information from different parts. A lot of neurons analyze the information from the hand because there's a big sensory input. And neurons, they want to generate action potential. And they used to have a lot of signal move in because we use our hand a lot. And suddenly this person lose the arm. And now these neurons have nothing to do. They're not happy. And neurons, they always are capable of generating new connection. We call it neuroplasticity. They will extend their axon out, their dendrite, they can form a new connection. So when these neurons have no connection, they will extend out, connect with other neurons. And once they connect, okay, they can receive input. And now the pain sensation move in to touch this neuron, they connect with this one. Okay, when this neuron fire, what's their job? The hand. So the subject feel like the hand hurt, even though they don't have the hand anymore. So it's the phantom pain does not come from the physical stimulus. It comes from the neuronal connectivity. And some of the subject have to use a morphine to stop the pain. It's very painful. And about 80% of those amputees report they have certain level of phantom pain. And also some of them report their sensation shift to different body parts. Still, we use this to explain. Like you touch the face, why they feel like their hand been touched? Because these neurons gonna extend their axon out, connect with their neighbor. And their neighbor is the face part. So a lot of them feel like, okay, when you touch their face, and the neuron go to here, and the input go to here, and they feel like their hand been touched. Still, the signal comes from the neuron. So the take-home message for the sensory system is your sensation actually does not come from the physical stimulus. Your sensation comes from the neuronal activity. Okay, let's stop here.